Hello gamers, it's Tom Sidener, the Lonely Gamer, and today we're going to take a look at the game Tesla vs. Edison by Dirk Niemeyer and put out by Artana Games. It is a game for 2 to 5 players where you're going to play inventors during the time of the current wars, and you're going to try to have the most productive stock portfolio at the end of the game. Let's take a look at the game and see what comes in the game. Okay, so the game comes with a rule book. Now this is a pretty good rule book. I had to read through this rule book about 3 or 4 times to make sure that I got all of the instructions down perfectly, so it's not as clear and as concise as some rule books, but the one thing I do like is it does have these sidebar rules which actually kind of break down things in just a specific notation, where if you're just looking for a specific thing, like a walkthrough, the sidebar kind of gives you a walkthrough of each action that the people can do on their turn, and I do kind of like that. I found myself referencing these side notes more than the full rule book at many times throughout the game. It made it much quicker to look up a question. But it is a decent rule book, and it does answer almost all your questions. I think there was one question that I couldn't find in the rule book that I had an answer to. It wasn't as clear on one point, and I will try to point that out in the video. But a nice rule book, well written, and a pretty good at giving you all the things you need to know to play the game, minus maybe one small thing. It also comes with some cubes for each inventor. Each inventor is color-coded, and there's a cube that's coded to that color that matches their stock, and there's 5 different colors because there are 5 inventors in the game. And let's go ahead and talk about those. So the inventors, of course, are Nikola Tesla and Thomas Edison. These are the 2 inventors that names are on the box, so it makes sense that those 2 inventors are in there. But there's also 3 more inventors that were popular during the current wars, and they are also included in the box, and so they are Charles F. Brush, Eli Thompson, and Sir Hiram Maxim. Okay, so you are going to be in this game playing one of these 5 inventors, and throughout the game you're going to be trying to get contracts, you're going to try to develop your technologies, and you're going to try to push propaganda that pushes the sentiment of the time into the technologies that you are promoting. And if you're promoting DC and you're pushing the sentiment that way, then DC is going to be more popular, and it's going to bring you your stock portfolio higher rankings for your company. And if you're pushing AC, then it's going to be just the opposite. So we'll take a look at that a little later, but these are the inventors that you can play. Each inventor has stock certificates that go with their inventor. So these are the Maxim certificates, the Tesla certificates, the Thompson certificates, the Edison certificates, and the Brush certificates. You also have preferred stock in each company, and the person who plays the specific inventor actually gets the preferred stock for their company. This stock cannot be sold or traded, and so you always have this at the end of the game, and the preferred stock is worth 4 times the original stock, so it's worth 4 times the value. So you're always going to have 4 times your stock value in your own company. And then you're also going to have stock in other companies. You can actually buy and trade and sell stocks throughout the game of other people's companies. So you don't always have to be the person with the most valuable company to win the game. If you're smart enough to invest in the person who has the most valuable company, then you may be the winner of the game just by piggybacking off of the person who is doing the best in the game for their stocks. So you're also going to get some luminaries in the game that are going to help you to build your stock portfolio and build your business and build your technologies. And those luminaries are going to come in 2 versions. There are level 1 luminaries, and level 1 luminaries are going to be available to you at the beginning of the game, and then throughout the game, as long as they're not taken by other people. And then you're going to have level 2 luminaries, which are going to show up in the second phase, and then also extend through the rest of the game. Some of these luminaries are people like Edwin J. Houston, Charles Batchelor, John Crosey, Charles A. Coffin, Edwin Rice, Oliver Schellensberg, J.P. Morgan from the J.P. Morgan Chase, Lewis Latimer, Harold P. Brown, William Arnold Anthony, Benjamin Lamming, Francis Lloyd Stetson, William Stanley Jr., Charles P. Steintz, Henry Villard, Stanford White, Thompson Lawson, and George Westinghouse. Now, all of these people are actual people who were around during that time period. This is a very educational game. There's a lot of flavor text on these cards, which kind of tells you what these guys were into during the time and how they influenced the current wars, and you know, what kind of things that they added. Now, each one of these luminaries is going to have some stats on them. If you can see, I'm going to show this to the camera here. They're going to have stats for invention, manufacturing, finance, and propaganda. Those are going to give you bonuses in the game when you use those. Each one is different. You can see that this one's a pretty well-rounded luminary because it has one in each one of those categories, whereas J.P. Morgan is pretty much all finance. He's going to give you two in the finance, but he's going to give you nothing in invention, manufacturing, or propaganda. And that's going to become very important during the game. You're also going to receive level 1, level 2, and level 3 propaganda cards that you're going to get to, that you're going to have available to you in each phase. They are things like other luminaries that you can't actually use as luminaries, but there are other influential people in the time period that's going to give you bonuses. Let me take a look at one of these cards. It's going to give you a bump in cash. So this guy will give you $4,000, and it will also give you a bump in propaganda. Towards this one will give you one bump towards AC/DC. So you can either move AC up one or AC down one, or DC up one or DC down one using this propaganda. And there's all kinds of different propaganda. There's accidental electrocution, so somebody accidentally got electrocuted, so it's going to adjust the AC/DC to one way or the other, and it's going to give you some money. There's also things like the first electric Christmas tree, which was propaganda in favor of one of the luminaries, so that star there means that you can move yourself up to on the fame track, or you can move somebody else down to on the fame track, and we'll see how that works here in a moment. You're also going to get some money. The money is paper money, but it's fairly thick. It's really nice quality thick paper money. It comes in denominations of 1,000, 5,000, 10,000, 20,000, and 50,000. So you get quite a bit of money. We played a 5-player game and the money did get kind of low. We had to start making change. But if you start making change, there's enough money there to definitely carry you through the game. So the last thing we're going to look at is the board. I'm going to get that set up. I'll be right back in a minute and we'll take a look at that on the table. Okay, so here's the board you're going to be playing on for Tesla versus Edison. It's got some area up here. This is different parts of the country, different cities where you're going to be trying to vie for contracts. The different cities are different sizes, so as you can see, this is a small city, Albany, represented by this icon here. And then you've got medium cities like Buffalo, which is represented by this icon here. And then you've got large cities like Boston, which are represented by this icon here. And depending on the size of the city, it's going to depend on how much it's going to cost you to try to garner a contract in that area, and also how much your stock is going to increase by getting a contract in that area. So as you can see, a small city is going to cost you 4,000 base price, and it's going to give you 4 stock base price. And then it's going to be 8,000 base price for a medium city and plus 5 stock base for a medium city. And then a large city is going to be 12,000 base price and plus 6 base. Now, I say base because there are other things that are going to adjust the cost and the stock. Now, what's going to adjust the cost? Well, first of all, the cost is going to be adjusted by your connections between your cities. So let's say I was Tesla and Tesla is going to be the blue player. And I've already started to develop contracts in Toledo, which is a level one small city. If I try to get a contract in another city, if it's right next to me, then there's no extending price that I have to pay to actually branch to this adjacent city. But let's say I want to branch out to Pittsburgh here. Then I have to either go through Cleveland or Columbus to get there. And if I do not have contracts in those locations, then there is a penalty that I must pay. And that penalty is going to be 1,000 times the phase that we're in. So in the first phase, it would cost me 1,000 extra. So instead of 4, it would be 5,000. Or in this case, instead of 8, it would be 9,000. Or if I was in phase 2, it would cost me an extra 2,000. And if I was in phase 3, it would cost me an extra 3,000. And that is based on how many cities you have to go through. So if I was going to try to go to Philadelphia, and I was going to go through Cleveland and Pittsburgh, then it would cost me 2,000 in the first phase, 4,000 in the second phase, and 6,000 in the third phase to actually bypass these cities. So when you're getting contracts, you're wanting to try to get contracts that are as close to you as possible, because it's going to save you money. One thing I want to note, that in a three-player game, you're only going to use certain areas of the board. If you look really closely, you can see that the board is divided into different areas here based on the number of players. And so there's a dividing line here for two-player, there's a dividing line here for three-player, and then four-player and five-player. So if we were playing a three-player game, contracts would only be available in this area of the board. You cannot buy any contracts past this line. Five players, the whole thing is open. The other thing that's going to adjust your monetary cost is your luminary. So if you're using a luminary that has money, let's say we're using Sheer Maxim, which your main characters are also considered luminaries. Let's say you're using Sheer Maxim to get a contract, then he is going to get a $1,000 deduction right there, because he has one money, times the phase. So in the first phase, he would get 1,000 off. So if you were just branching out connectively, this would only cost you 3,000, because there's no penalty and he's giving you a 1,000 deduction. If you were doing this in the third phase, he would get a 3,000 deduction, because it's 1 times 3. So then you would actually only pay 1,000 with no penalty to branch out here. So when you're buying contracts, that's kind of how it works. Another thing that you're going to be doing on this board is you're going to be elevating yourself in fame. This is the fame track right here. There is a present and a future fame track. So each person has a cube on the present or future fame track. Whenever you adjust fame within the game, you always adjust the future fame track. So if you played some propaganda that allowed you to move up on the fame track, then you would move your future self on the fame track. So let's say that Brush, which is the green guy, decides that he's going to move up on the fame track 3. He would go 1, 2, 3 on the future fame track. His current present fame would stay the same until the end of the round, when this gets adjusted. So the fame track, the person who's at the top of it gets some stock advance at the end of each round. The person that's at the top, closest to the top, gets to go first, and so on and so forth. So the fame actually helps you in your stock price and in what order you go in the game. So you'll want to adjust your fame to allow you to make the bigger moves earlier, before other people are able to do that. So another thing that you can that you're going to be dealing with here is the AC/DC tract. There's going to be a starting cube here on the neutral section of the AC/DC track. Now, currently at this point, AC and DC are both as popular with the people. There's no influx or push one way or another. But as the game goes on, you can use propaganda to move it towards the AC side or towards the DC side. If you move it toward the AC side, then contracts purchased using AC are going to garner you more stock. So as you can see here, this would be a base of 4, but if AC was really popular and you were using AC, then you could actually get 6 stock bump out of your contract instead of four, and the same goes with DC. There's also a negative connotation if you're way up here. So if DC is here and it's negative two for DC, then if I get a contract using DC as my power of choice, then I am going to get four minus two here, and it's going to cut my stock price down. So how do we move the technologies? Well, each inventor is going to have a cube on each one of the technologies, and you can use luminaries to help you to move up the technology scales. So there's AC and there's DC, and the AC-DC track here is going to determine what is more popular with the people. And then you have bulbs. Now, in order to get a contract, you have to have either AC or DC in the level that you're trying to get the contract in, and you also have to have bulbs for the level you're trying to get the contact, you're trying to get the contract in. So at the current state of the board, Tesla and Brush could only get contracts that are level one, because they both have level one AC, level one DC, and level one bulb. So in order to get a contract, I could only get Toledo or Albany or Lynn or any other level one contract. Now, in order to increase my technology in these items, I have to use a luminary, and I have to be able to pay the requirements cost to move up to the level. So in order to move myself up in AC to level two, I have to have one technology and one manufacturing on my luminary. And if I want to buy a patent in that level, then I'm going to need to have one monetary as well. So let's take Sir Hiram Maxim as an example. If I wanted to use Sir Hiram Maxim to actually raise my AC to level two, I could definitely do that, because I meet the technology requirement, I meet the manufacturing requirement, and I have a one in the monetary requirement. So I could actually say that I could raise my technology. Let's go ahead and get Sir Maxim's cubes out here. So I could say I'm going to raise my AC to level two. I would use him to do so, and I would move up here. Now, because I have one monetary there, I could go ahead and buy a patent. So I'm going to go ahead and buy the patent for level two. Now, anybody who buys a contract that's level two on the board and they use AC as their current of choice, they're going to have to pay me $2,000 for the level two patent that I own. So if I have a patent in bulbs at level two, they'd have to pay me $4,000 if I had both of them. Or if I had a DC and they were using DC, they'd have to pay me two as well. You also can move up in bulbs and in DC the same way. If I say that Maxim moved up in bulbs as well. And then let's say that Maxim wanted to get a contract and he wanted to get a level two. Well, he could get a level two contract because he has level two in AC and he has level two in bulb, but he could not get that contract in DC. So he would have to claim that contract in AC. So therefore, if DC was here and it had a plus two in DC and a minus two in AC, then Hiram would be able to go ahead and claim a contract. Let's say he's going to claim a contract in level two in Columbus. He would be able to claim this contract. He would pay $4,000 for the contract. He would only get two advancement in his company stock, because he's going to get four minus the two because he had to use AC, because he only has AC available. He does not have level two DC that he can use in the game. The other thing that each player is going to have is they're going to have a stock portfolio, and they're going to have stock indicators on the stock track. Everybody's stock indicator will always start at the 12 position on the board and then move up from there. So let's say that Sir Hiram Maxim actually got this contract at level two. It's a small, so it would raise his stock four. Let's say the AC-DC was currently at neutral, so there's no adjustment in the stock price. So then his stock would go up 1, 2, 3, 4. And his stock would now be worth $8,000 per share, where Tesla and Brush's stock is still only worth $4,000 per share. And so that's how your stock moves. Your stock can move in several different ways. So the first way your stock can move is by buying contracts. Your stock can also move when you buy patents. So because Maxim bought the level 2 patent in the AC system, his stock would go up 2 spaces. Your stock would go up 3 spaces for a level 3, 4 spaces for a level 4, and 5 spaces for a level 5. Your stock will also increase based on you being the highest person on the fame track. So at the end of the round, if Maxim was the highest person at the fame track during phase 1, he would go up 1 stock. During phase 2, he would go up 2 stock. And during phase 3, he would go up 3 stock. Also, your stock can increase when somebody buys your stock. So let's say that the Brush player bought some Maxim stock so he could have some Maxim stock in his portfolio because it looks like Maxim is doing really well in the game. Then if it was phase 1 and his stock was purchased, he would go up 1 stock. If it was phase 2, he would go up 2. And if it was phase 3, he would go up 3. One of the things about this game, and one of the probably the most fiddly thing about this game, is that a lot of things are multiplied by the phase number. The phase number is notated here on the phase track. We always start in turn 1 and we always start in phase 1. So a lot of things in the game have to be multiplied by the phase number, and those are things you have to remember. And there's a couple things that are not multiplied by the phase number, like the patent cost. So those are things you have to remember are not multiplied by the phase cost. And I think when playing this game, that was one of the things that was the most confusing for me, was that what is multiplied by the phase and what is not. But after a few playthroughs, it became pretty obvious what you multiply by the phase number and what you don't. Okay, so let's go through the basic setup for the start of a game, and we're going to have a 3-player game here. So let's do the basic setup for a 3-player game for Tesla versus Edison. The first thing you're going to do is everybody is going to go through and they're going to pick a inventor that they want to use during the game. You're going to have to randomly determine who's going to be the first player, and then you're going to go clockwise around the table. So the first player is going to go ahead and look at the cards and select their inventor, primary luminary, that they want to use in the game. So let's say I'm going to choose Nikola Tesla as my luminary. So I'm going to take the Nikola Tesla card and set it out in front of me. Because I'm the first player, I'm going to take one of my cubes and I'm going to put it on the present and the future fame track at the bottom. So because I'm the first player, I'm going to actually start out at the bottom of the fame track. I'm also going to take one of my cubes and put it on the AC system at number 1 technology. I'm going to take one of my cubes and put it at bulbs number 1 technology, and I'm also going to put it at the DC number 1 technology. I'm also going to take one of my cubes and I'm going to place it on the starting point for the stock portfolio. I am going to be giving the preferred stock certificate for my company. So I am Tesla, so I'm going to get the preferred stock certificate for Tesla. We are also going to place a starting cube on the AC-DC track, which is going to start in the neutral position. We are also going to set a cube on the turns track on turn 1. The selection process is going to go to the next player. The next player is going to pick their luminary. They are going to take their luminary. Let's say that person chose Maxim as their luminary. They're going to take their Maxim person. They're going to take their preferred stock certificate for Maxim. They're going to put their cubes on the next level of the fame track. They are also going to put one cube on each one of the technologies tracks, and they are going to put one cube on the starting stock location. And then the third person in a 3-player game is going to pick their luminary, and let's say they pick Brush as their luminary. They're going to take their luminary, their primary luminary, and they're going to take their preferred stock certificate. They are also going to put theirs on the technology tracks. They are going to put their cubes on the next level of the fame track, and they are going to put a cube on the stock track. Once everybody has their primary luminaries, then the next thing we're going to do is we're going to do a luminary auction, and that's going to be based on the number of players. And so we're going to look on the chart. There's a chart in the book, and the chart says that for three players, we're going to have five luminaries in phase one and four luminaries in phase two. So we're going to take the phase one luminaries, we're going to shuffle them up, and we're going to put out five luminaries for the initial luminary auction. So everybody's going to start the game with their primary luminary and then a secondary luminary. So the bidding will start with Brush. He will get the pick who he wants to bid on, and he says he's going to bid on JP Morgan, and so he automatically bids $1,000. And let's say that Maxim says that he passes, and Tesla says that he'll give $2,000, and then Brush says he'll give $3,000, and Tesla passes, then Brush would pay $3,000 to the bank, and he gets JP Morgan, goes in front of him into his column. Brush has got somebody, so we move down to Maxim. Maxim says he wants Stellinger. He bids $1,000. Tesla says he passes, so Maxim will pay $1,000 to the bank. He'll take Stellinger. And then Tesla says that he wants Latimer. He doesn't have to bid against anybody, so he pays $1,000 also. Latimer comes into his corner. And then Brown and Houston will actually stay out on the table, and they will be available in the next luminary auction. So we also put out the stock certificates. We put out four stock certificates for each person. So out on the table, you're going to, in a market, available market for stock certificates, we're going to put out four stock certificates for each person. And we're going to save two stock certificates for the luminary auctions in the previous round. So I'm going to just put those off to the side where I can use them in the next. The same thing goes for the other two companies that are in the game. And we are now all set up and we're ready to start the game. It would start with Brush. The player playing Brush would actually go first, and then the player playing Maxim would go second. No matter where they're sitting around the table, it would go in this order, and the person playing Tesla would go third. On your turn, you're going to use one or both of your luminaries to take an action, and then once your action is done, you're going to pass to the next player. Once everybody has used up all of their luminaries to take actions and has no more actions they can take, then the round ends, and then you go into the end of round stuff that we will talk about later in this video. So let's talk about what you do on your turn. So on your turn, it's pretty simple. You are going to utilize one or many of your luminaries to take actions in the game. And there are only five different actions that you can take in the game. The first action you're going to be able to do is you're going to be able to claim a contract. Now, claiming a contract has several things that you do. The first thing you do is you determine which contract that you want to claim. So let's say in this case we wanted to claim Toledo. The next thing you do is you say what luminary you are going to use to claim that contract. And you can only use one luminary to claim a contract. So you're going to say what luminary you're going to use. In this case, I have the choice of Maxim or Westinghouse. Now, both of them are going to give me a one in monetary, so one deduction in paying the price for claiming that. So it doesn't really matter which I use. The one thing that I want to think about is what I want to do with the other person. And so I may want to use Westinghouse because he has less technology and less manufacturing that can be used for advancing in technology. So let's say I wanted to go ahead and claim a contract. I could say I'm going to use George Westinghouse. The next thing you declare is what technology you're going to use for that contract that you're going to claim. So let's say I'm going to use AC for that. So I'm going to say I'm going to use AC to to do that contract, I have to have bulbs and one of the currents in the level that I'm going to be using. Then I'm going to determine the cost for buying the contract. So in this case, because this is my first contract, there's not going to be any penalty for non-adjacent cities. So it's going to be a small, so it's going to be 4. And then I do not owe any patents to anybody because nobody has the patents that I need to claim this location. So it's just going to be 4. I'm going to pay 3 to the bank because it's phase 1. And I'm going to get a -1 deduction. So I'm going to pay 3 to the bank. I'm going to flip this guy over because I have now used him to claim the contract. And then I'm going to raise my stock price by 4 because we're at neutral on the AC-DC track. And I'm going to move my stock marker accordingly. So 1, 2, 3, 4. All right? So that is the first action that you have available to you during your turn is purchase a contract. The second action that you have available to you during your turn is you can advance in technologies. So to advance in technologies, you're going to move up based on your luminary that you choose. So let's say in this case I wanted to move up to AC level 3, then I would say I am going to use Sir Hiram to move up to AC level 3. I need 2 technology and 1 manufacturing. When I have that, I have 2 and 2. I also have $1 in my finances, so I can actually go ahead and say I'm going to move up. You just move your marker to the next level, and then I am going to buy the patent for that since I have the dollar. So I'm going to put that on, and because I bought the patent for that, I'm going to move my stock up 1, 2, 3 because it's a level 3 and I just purchased the patent for that. Now at this point I could not get level 3 contracts because I do not have level 3 in bulbs, but anybody who does get a level 3 contract and uses AC is going to have to pay me $3,000 for my patent. So I use this guy to actually advance, and so I would turn that over. Now, a couple things that you can do when it comes to advancing technologies, you can jump. So if I had enough, if I was here and I had enough technology and manufacturing to jump 2 spaces, I could do that. So in this case, if I wanted to go up to level 4 and bypass level 3, then what I would do is I would need 3 technology and 3 manufacturing. So I do not have that with Sir Hiram Maxim here. I do not have 3 and 3, but one thing that I can do during the advanced technology phase is I can combine my luminaries. So I could say I'm going to combine both of these. I'm going to use these both together. That gives me 3 and 3, so I'm going to jump to level 4. Now, we're going back, so we're saying we didn't go to 3. So I still could buy the patent for level 4 since I have $2 now in my finances. So I could go ahead and buy that patent. I would have moved up on the stock 4 instead of 3, so let's go one more. But I would not be able to have the level 3 patent because you only can buy the patent on the one you land on. So if I jumped over that one, I could not buy the patent for both of these. I would only be able to buy this patent, but it would highly advance me in the AC wars. And if AC is up on the AC track, then it's going to give me higher stock bumps for buying contracts using the AC. If I use both of my luminaries to do that, if I combine them, then both of them would get turned over. So this is a way to highly advance yourself, but it also limits your number of turns that you're going to get in a round, because during the rounds you're going to get 1 turn per luminary unless you combine them. Another thing you can do on your turn is you can engage in propaganda. So in order to engage in propaganda, what you're going to do is you're going to pick one of your luminaries to do the propaganda. And so in this case, Sir Hiram Maxim has 2 in propaganda, so I would probably pick him. You say you're going to do propaganda with your luminary, then you pick one of the tracks, either the Fame track or the AC-DC track, and you increase them or decrease them based on your propaganda score. This is one of those things where you do not multiply it by the phase number. So this is one of those things you have to remember. So if I'm Sir Hiram Maxim and I'm going to say, okay, I'm going to use my propaganda to increase AC by 2. I could have said I'm going to increase my popularity by 2, but there's really no reason because I'm all the way at the top. Now, if I wanted to make sure I stayed at the top, I could increase my popularity by 2 like this, and then it makes it harder for somebody to come and pass me. But in this case, I think the best thing for me is to go ahead and increase AC by 2 and get the stock bump up, because I'm probably going to be doing most of my stuff in AC because that's what I'm advancing on the technology track. The other thing you do when you do propaganda is during each phase there are going to be several propaganda cards available for you to take, and you are going to take one of those propaganda cards that are available to you if there's any available. Now, there could be a situation where there are no propaganda cards available, but if there's propaganda cards available, you get to take one. So I have the phase 2 propaganda cards here. I'm just going to lay a few out just so you can get an idea. So along with moving one of the tracks based on my propaganda, I also get to take a card. And so in this case, I think I'll take the this card here. This is whoever cries first loses. I'd take that card. I would get the monetary award that the card gives me. So this one gives me a 7,000 monetary award. And then I would also get to advance one of the tracks based on this. Now, this one says I can either raise or lower the AC-DC track. And I'm definitely going to raise it because I'm going for AC and I want to get that up to the top. Once you take this card, it is removed from the game and it's put back in the box. And then it's no longer available to anybody else. And then what's available is the remaining propaganda cards. Once you've done your propaganda, then you flip your card over and you move over to the next turn. The next thing you can do on your turn is visit the stock market. The same with everything else, you have to use one of your luminaries to visit the stock market. You're going to get a increase or decrease on your purchases or sales depending on the luminary you use and depending on the phase in the game. So let's say I use George Westinghouse to go to the stock market. He is going to give me a 1,000 increase or decrease times the phase number depending on whether I'm buying or selling. And let's say I'm going to use George Westinghouse and I want to purchase some stock in another company. So let's say I want to purchase stock in Brush's company. So I look on the stock chart and I can see that the cost for Brush's company is $4,000. He is going to give me a $1,000 deduction because we are in phase 1. So I am going to pay $3,000 and I'm going to take a stock certificate for Brush's company. Now I keep these. Now at the end of the game, the sole basis for who wins the game is on the stock portfolio of each person. So it doesn't matter how much money you have, how many contracts you have, how much technology you have. It all boils down to your stock portfolio and what it's worth. So you want to buy stock in companies that are doing well. So when you buy a stock in a company, you're going to get your discount. The other thing you're going to do is you're going to raise the stock of the company that you bought based on the phase. So it's phase 1, so we're going to move Brush's company up 1 because I bought one of his stocks. You can buy as many stock as you want, as much as you can afford during a round. So let's say I also wanted to buy stock in Tesla's company. Let's say I wanted to buy 3 stock in Tesla's company. That's a lot, and normally you wouldn't do that, but I want to show you what would happen to the stock. So let's say we bought 3. So it's at 4 right now. So I buy my first one at 4 minus my 1 discount. So that's going to be 3. So I'm going to pay 3. He's going to move up, and I'm going to get a Tesla stock certificate. Then I'm going to buy another one. He's still at 4. So I'm going to pay 3 again because I get my 1 deduction. He's going to go up 1. And I'm going to get another stock certificate. And then I'm going to buy another one. So then now I have to pay $6,000 for it minus my 1. So that's going to be 5. So I'm going to pay $5,000 for it. He's going to go up 1. And I'm going to get another stock certificate. So I can buy as many stock on my turn as I can afford. Now you can sell as many stock on your turn as you would like, but the one caveat is that you cannot sell stock in a company that you purchased this turn. So you cannot buy a bunch of Tesla stock and then turn around and sell it. So that's the only caveat. So let's say I had stock in my own company, Maxim, and I wanted to sell that stock because the stock is pretty much up there. It's 20,000 each. I could sell this stock because I didn't purchase it this turn. So let's say I'm going to sell one stock. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to look and see what it's worth. So it's worth 20. Plus I get a 1,000 bump because we're in the first phase and I have one monetary on the guy I'm using. So then I'm going to get 21,000. So I'm going to take 21,000 from the bank. I'm going to return my stock certificate to the available stock certificates for other people to buy. And the thing is, the stock is going to be moved down based on the sale one entire column. So it's going to move to the left. So as you can see, if you have a lot of stock in somebody's company, you can really tank their stock price by selling a bunch of their stock. So you could buy a lot of stock in somebody towards the end of the game, sell off all their stock, and move their stock price way down. You can see that I moved it down from 20 to 16 just by selling one share of my own stock, which is probably something that you wouldn't do. But for this example, it kind of shows how you can manipulate the stock market by buying and selling stock. Once you're done, you would turn your luminary over to show that you used him for that round, and you would move over to the next person's turn. The last and final action that you can do on your turn is pass. And if you pass, you still have to exhaust a luminary in order to pass. So I could say that I don't want to do anything this turn. I've run out of options. And so I'm going to go ahead and just pass, and I'm going to use Sir Hiram Maxim to pass. Once all of your luminaries are turned over, then that is going to be the end of your time in this round, and it will just continue with the other players' turns until everybody is done using all their luminaries, and then their round will end. And this is what happens when the round ends. The first thing you do at the end of the round is you change the present fame track to match the future fame track. So let's say during the game that the future fame track was changed to look like this. At the end of the round, we would change the present to match it. So that's the first thing we do. The next thing we do is we advance a stock price for the person who is in the lead on the fame track. So in this case, it was Maxim, and it's phase one, so he would go up one. The next thing we do is we advance the stock price of the company with the highest level in the winning phase. So right now we look and we see that AC is winning. So we look at AC, who's got the highest patent in AC, and that is Maxim. So he also will increase based on the phase, and so it's phase one, so he's going to go up one for that. The next thing we're going to do is each company is going to take its profits. So Brush is going to get $4,000. Tesla is going to get $6,000 based on his stock price, and Maxim is going to get $20,000 here based on the stock price. So each one of those would be divvied out to the player it goes to. Then we would flip all of our luminaries face up to get ready for the next round. We advance the turn marker to the next turn, and if we happen to advance the turn marker across the phase, then we have a luminary option. And during the luminary auctions, it's going to allow you to get more luminaries to be used on your turn. So as we move farther and farther through the turn marker, there's going to be more and more things you can do because you're going to have more and more luminaries to use on your turn. Once we're at the last round and we're told to advance and we can't advance anymore, then the game would end. So at the end of the game, you're going to add up all of your stock certificates based on what they're worth. Now remember that your preferred stock certificate is worth 4, so you're going to take 4 times whatever your stock is, and then you're also going to add up all of your other stock certificates that you have. And the person who has the highest value in stock certificates is going to be the winner of the game. Now, one last thing I want to talk about is the luminary auction. So during each phase, you're going to put out a number of luminaries based on the number of players that will be auctioned. At the beginning of the game, you're going to auction off luminaries, and it's just going to be the luminaries. There's not going to be any stock certificates associated with them. But during the second phase luminary auction and the third phase luminary auction, the luminaries are also going to have stock certificates associated with them, which are going to make them more valuable and make more people want them. The luminary options are pretty simple. The first thing you're going to do is you're going to put out the luminaries based on the number of players. So we are doing a three-player game. So in a three-player game, you are going to have five luminaries that are going to be available for the auction. So I'm going to randomly select five luminaries here. You're going to put those out so that everybody can see them. This is at the beginning of the game. The player who's the first player, who's the highest player on the fame track, is going to pick one of the luminaries and say, I want to bid for Lewis Latimer, let's say. That person is going to automatically bid 1,000, and then it's going to go around the table, and people can make bids in 1,000 increments until somebody outbids everybody. And that person who outbids everybody is going to pay the bank, and they're going to take Lewis Latimer, all right? Once Lewis Latimer is out, then that person who got him is out of the bidding, and then it goes to the next player in order, or back to the first player if that person did not get the person that they bid on originally. You keep doing that until everybody has a luminary, and then the auction ends. Any luminaries, let's say if it was a three-player game, three of these would get taken, there would be two left. These luminaries actually go to the next round. In the next round, you're going to do four luminaries, so you're going to take them from the level two luminaries, and so we're going to take four. These luminaries are going to be available, but also there are going to be stock certificates associated with it. So at the beginning of the game, you're going to take out two stock certificates for each player in the game, and those stock certificates are going to be put aside for luminary auctions. We currently have Maxim, Brush, and Tesla in this game, so we're going to take the six stock certificates, two from each, we're going to shuffle them up, and we're going to place them on the luminaries that are out there. So something like this, and it's random. I didn't do a very good job of shuffling, but as you can see, so each one of them has a stock certificate on them, and those stock certificates stay on them. So during the second luminary auction, which would happen between right after the turn two and before turn three, then you would do the same thing. The leader on this board would actually pick somebody, let's say Edwin Johnson, and then the bidding would start at 1,000 for the leader, and then you would go around, and whoever actually wins the auction would take Edwin Johnson and the stock certificate. So sometimes the stock certificate becomes more important than the luminary itself. The same thing goes once somebody gets a person, they're out of the bidding, the other people finish up the bidding until everybody has a luminary, then the last luminaries that are left will be left for the last phase between turns four and five, and then the last luminaries would be given out, and that would be all the luminaries in the game. And that's how you do the luminary auctions. So that's Tesla versus Edison. It is a really fun game. It's a very thinky game. It kind of reminds me of a really, really advanced Monopoly, because you're dealing with a lot of money. A lot of money's changing hands. Your stocks are changing. You're getting money for patents when people will use your technologies if you have the patents in those areas. Really good game. I think the trickiest part about the game is understanding that it doesn't matter how much money you have at the end of the game. It's the stock portfolio, which is what makes you win or lose the game. Now, there is a situation that if there's a tie between stock portfolio, then the person with the most money wins the game, but that's going to be kind of rare, and you're better off to buy stock in the companies you think are going to be the companies that are going to excel during the game, so that you have the highest stock portfolio in the game. So that's it. I really like the game. I give it two thumbs up. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments, and I'll try to answer them the best I can. Otherwise, until I see you again, happy gaming.